Welcome to the April 25th Board of Selectmen's meeting. Please join me in a pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. First on the agenda tonight is recognition of service. We have couple of the elected officials who are no longer serving in the audience tonight, and we're going to present a plaque. And could we have Eileen Latimer, please?
Okay, resolution of recognition of service. Whereas Eileen Latimer has served the people of the town of Hampton with dedication and loyalty as a member of the Municipal Budget Committee from 2001 to 2016. And whereas Eileen Latimer served with distinction, providing guidance and leadership during her tenure as a member, as vice chairman, and as chairman of the Municipal Budget Committee. And whereas Eileen Latimer has served the town above and beyond the call of duty on many occasions, at personal sacrifice. We have resolved that the selectmen and the citizens of the town of Hampton make known their appreciation for the services that Eileen Latimer has rendered to the town of Hampton, whereunto we have set our hands and seals this 28th day of March in the year of our Lord 2016, the 377th year of the incorporation of the town of Hampton, and 337th year of the founding of the state of New Hampshire, and the 239th year of independence of the United States of America.
Thank you very much. It's been my pleasure to serve.
Mr. Chairman, if I may interrupt, Ms. Nickerson has emailed that she is unable to attend. She has a personal issue, and so if we can reschedule that presentation
right.
For her.
We had also plaques for Sandy Nickerson and Mary Louise Wolseley and Dennis Blaine, and they've unable to attend tonight, so we'll try to do that another time. But thank you very much for your service. Moving on, we'll go to public comment.
Good evening, Norman Soberdick, 70 Tide Mill Road, speaking on behalf of Rational Taxpayers of Hampton. One of our goals is to is we function for the taxpayers. We're sticklers to rules, processes, procedures with regards to the town's business. And we were very concerned last year when the town was sued by Waste Management because we didn't follow purchasing policies correctly, and EcoMaine was given a sole source contract. Ultimately, the awarding of the contract to Waste Management as a result of a lawsuit caused the town pleasurably to save a lot of money in the order of $500,000. Now it's because we didn't follow procedures of getting three bidders or searching for them. And the encumbrances that took place at year end have been a great concern to us. And so I asked under Right to Know Law to take a look at one of them, Howard Systems. And I then did an investigation of it, and I sent Jim Waddell my findings, which would indicate to me, especially after the chief had stated that he hadn't done any research on it yet, and that was in mid-January. And my research indicated that we had a proposal, we had a purchase order, nobody had signed it, we had no alternative bidders, although there are many that can provide the service. And even last week, the chief was discussing Howard Systems because they had done some work in Rye. And everything that I saw and what I reviewed indicated this was not a legal binding purchase order. It was a placeholder. We've done this in the past. It's a bad practice. It isn't the way to do business. We need to have, you're an auditor. If you had seen that practice and doing any audits, it would have been unacceptable. And this isn't the way to do business. You need to get bids. You need to have a proper procedure. It's not that the system, the video system, is the wrong thing. The whole goal was to avoid having warrant articles approved by the taxpayers. This was a complete technique to avoid the system. I don't think it's a good business practice. And I think just having you approve something without questioning it doesn't serve the taxpayers at all. I would ask, on behalf of rational taxpayers, that you go back and look at every one of the existing encumbrances to see if they meet the definition of whether it's a legally binding contract at the end of December. I doubt you'll find that that's the case. I respectfully request that you do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anybody else for public comment?
Hi, I'm Rayanne Dione. I'm the Hampton Conservation Coordinator. And I just wanted to remind property owners in Hampton that the Conservation Commission, is holding their second annual rain garden cost share grant opportunity. This means that we help a homeowner design and size and install a rain garden. The owner is only responsible for 25% of the cost, up to $75. The rain gardens that we did last year, we did two residential ones. The materials alone ranged in the $400 to $500 range, so it's a great, great opportunity. Creating a rain garden is a great way for homeowners to help protect our rivers, streams, ponds, salt marsh, and ocean. A rain garden is simply a shallow depression that's planted with native plants and grasses. These gardens are sustainable, affordable, and particularly effective at capturing rainwater, preventing flooding, creating habitat for local wildlife such as birds and butterflies, and filtering up to 80% of pollutants such as household fertilizers, pesticides, and oils from our stormwater runoff. Applications are available upstairs at the town hall, and they are due by April 27th by 3 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else for public comment?
Good evening. Candy Stelmack, 488 High Street. Rayanne just reminded me by her being here, did we pass the warrant article that said we can't put fertilizer within 100 feet of streams? Because if we did, I would like to see something in writing so I can hand to my the landscapers and the guys that do the fertilizing and everything. And maybe she could give me some direction on that. The other thing, I want to ask you if during the upcoming old business, is it, or new business, on the grist mill, if you could put out some information for the people that keep querying us about how far along we are and when to expect some action. I don't have the answers, and I don't want to give out any false information. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else for public comment? Seeing none, we'll move on. Announcements and community calendar.
I have nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
I would just like to say that representatives from the state DOT are meeting on May 19th at the stage area down there at 5:30 before the regular meeting of Hampton
HBAC.
Area Commission.
Yeah. Is that open to the public?
Yes, they're looking for people to come and give input.
I just have one thing. Representative Emmerich, Tracy Emmerich, emailed me Monday, May 2nd at 10 a.m. in Representatives Hall. There's going to be a discussion. The topic is primary physician's perspective on the opioid crisis. It's a Dr. Savoyd, I think. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Internal medicine physician who is well known and respected. He not only serves as an expert witness for Massachusetts and Rhode Island in malpractice cases, but has worked with the New Hampshire Board of Medicine in an advisory role regarding opiate prescriptions. This presentation will be an hour long, and the doctor will take questions from the audience. And I believe it's open to the public. And with New Hampshire going through such a crisis in overdoses, it might be, if anybody wanted to, any of the selectmen want to go up to it, or anybody else, it would be a good thing. Very good. Moving on to the consent calendar.
So moved. Oh, pardon me.
2016 veteran requalifications, 2016 new veteran, 2016 elderly requalifications, 2016 new elderly, 2016 new disabled, library trustee appointment, Elizabeth Karok. Did I pronounce that right? Karok.
That sounds right.
Sounds good.
Sounds right.
Parade and public gathering license, McCarthy Strong, entertainment license and posted permits, Mac Restaurant Group, World's Greatest Karaoke Bar, 9A Ocean Boulevard, Boardwalk Cafe, 139 Ocean Boulevard, the Victorian Inn, 430 High Street. Accept donation from Waterline Industries of a Penn Valley sludge pump. Do I have a motion?
A motion.
Second.
All in favor? Consent calendar carries. Appointments. Burke Bennett, Commander, American Legion Post 35.
This may be the longest presentation of the evening.
It's a short one. That's fine.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Welch, good to see you again. Good evening. My name is Berkeley Bennett, and I live on Wayside Farm Lane in Hampton, and it's an honor to come before the board again once again this evening. I appeared before you tonight as commander of American Legion Post 35 here in Hampton, and I speak tonight on behalf of our over 330 members. Post 35 honors the commitment to preserve the memories and incidents of our associations in the Great Wars, as outlined in the preamble of the American Legion's Constitution. And part of that commitment is remembering our fallen service members on Memorial Day. On Monday, May 30th, our Memorial Day observances begin on Hampton Beach at 8 a.m. at the Marine Memorial in front of the Ashworth Hotel. Next, we'll have a ceremony at 9 a.m. on Weir Common in Hampton Falls. At 10 a.m., the Northampton Parade starts off at the Citizens Bank parking lot on Route 1, which is followed by services in front of the Northampton Town Offices on Atlantic Avenue. The Hampton Parade will begin at 11:30 a.m. instead of 11 as in years past, to give members of the post a little bit more time to travel back from the Northampton ceremony. The parade will begin in the parking lot next to the fire department and proceed westbound on Winneconnet, north on Route 1, east on High Street, culminating with a ceremony in the High Street Cemetery. Other major events Post 35 are sponsoring this year: the 9th annual Hit the Beach Wounded Warrior Program on Friday, August 26th at North Beach in Hampton. The program is spearheaded by Post 35 past commander Ralph Fatello, and last year was the largest ever, with almost 40 wounded warriors participating, spending a day in the water, and getting an introduction to surfing. And we couldn't do it without the support of over 80 volunteers on the beach, most of whom are from our local surfing community. Our Global War on Terrorism Monument rededication ceremony, Sunday, September 11th, at the Post on High Street. The monument honors those members of the armed forces from New Hampshire who have given their lives in service to our country during the global war on terrorism, all since September 11th, 2001. Last year, we were honored to have the American Legion National Commander, Dale Barnett, as well as Governor Maggie Hassan attend. Over 200 people were there, many of them families of the fallen. Veterans Day ceremonies, Friday, November 11th, will be at the Hampton Beach Marine Memorial 8, Hampton Falls at Weir Common at 9, Northampton at 10 in front of the town offices, and at Hampton at 11 a.m. in front of Post 35 on High Street. Unlike most VFW or Legion posts, we do not have a bar for income, and Post 35 is always heavily involved in fundraising. I'd like to thank the many people and local businesses, like the Bean Insurance Agency, who generously support the post and our efforts throughout the year. Some of the fundraisers we're holding this year, together with the Custom Kings Car Club, we will sponsor a car show at the Hampton Airfield on Saturday, May 7th, from 8 to 2 p.m. We'll have a yard sale on Saturday, May 14th at the Post on 69 High Street. We welcome all donations. And our primary fundraiser is our third annual Post 35 golf tournament on Friday, June 3rd at the Breakfast Hill Golf Club in Greenland. These tournaments have proven to be very successful, and a good time is had by all who attend. And this year, our tournament's also going to help benefit Run for the Fall in New Hampshire. And if I might just take another moment to highlight some of the Post's other projects. Post 35 is proud to be the charter organization of Boy Scout Troop 177 in Hampton. And with their help, we ensure that every grave of a veteran in the Hampton cemeteries, over 975 in all, is decorated with a flag for Memorial Day. And I'd just like to acknowledge Doug Aykroyd and Mike Dumont and the other adult leaders of Troop 177. They do a phenomenal job with volunteering much of their time to mentor the boys. And this summer, Charlie Gasparoni will become Troop 177's 50th Eagle Scout since 1933. On Flag Day, June 14th, the Post, with the support of Hampton Fire Department, and once again the help of Boy Scout Troop 177, will honorably dispose of unserviceable flags in a ceremony at the Hampton Fire Department. We award two scholarships to graduating Winneconnet High School seniors, as well as medals for scholastic and military excellence to two deserving members of the high school's Marine Corps Junior ROTC program. The Post also provides school awards to graduating eighth grade students of Hampton Academy and Sacred Heart School, as well as the Northampton School and Lincoln Anchorman in Hampton Falls. All the school awards recognize the qualities of courage, honor, leadership, patriotism, and service. We assist at the annual Run for the Fallen at Odeorn State Park, which is held the Sunday after September 11th, and this year will be held on September 18th. The run is dedicated to the same service members whose names are on our monument, those from New Hampshire who have laid down their lives for the cause of freedom since 9/11. And then, as I mentioned before, this year, Run for the Fall of New Hampshire will be a benefactor of our golf tournament on June 3rd. Post 35 not only donates Thanksgiving baskets during the holidays, but also participates in the Hampton School's Giving Tree program, ensuring local veteran families who might need a little helping hand enjoy a happy holiday season. This I'm particularly proud of. Last June, we participated in the services for Armory Corporal Elmer Richard of Exeter. Although he died while a POW during the Korean War, his remains were finally repatriated from North Korea last spring. Post 35 had the largest veteran contingent at the ceremonies, including the wake, the funeral, and the interment, with the sole exception of the Korean War Veterans Association. And finally, we sponsor programs that enrich the lives of young men and women in the state. We hold the American Legion Oratorical Contest, a constitutional speech program for high school students. And Post 35 also actively supports the American Legion Boys State Program, a highly respected and selective program of government instruction for high school junior boys. I must mention that we are indebted to the principals and staff at Winneconnet High School for helping to administer both of these programs in the school. On the Post viability, there is an opinion column today in the Union Leader that discussed the problems that veterans organizations are having in recruiting and keeping new members. I am proud to say that Post 35 does not share in that problem. We are recruiting younger veterans, both men and women, and some of them now hold leadership positions within the Post. In fact, some of our new members, Matt Rogers is our Sergeant at Arms, and Alan Arbo is our Post Adjutant, and Alan has just completed a new website for the Post at post35.us. We are actively engaged in the community, and in fact, Post 35 is a member of the Hamptons Area Chamber of Commerce. Once again, on membership, we used to joke that we were the little post on the coast. Well, I did some research here the other day on Legion membership in the state of New Hampshire. What I found was that not only have we exceeded our membership goals for the eighth year in a row, but we are now the ninth largest post of 100 posts in New Hampshire. A major test of the viability of Post 35 is this. If we closed our doors tomorrow and disbanded, would the community miss us? And I think the answer is a resounding yes. I'm grateful once again for the support and assistance of not only the Board of Selectmen, Town Manager Fred Welch, and Administrative Assistant Christina Ostman, but also for all the support from the citizens and businesses of Hampton, especially Desi Lanio with the 401 Tavern. Desi does so much for many causes, but he is one of our biggest supporters, and Hampton is very lucky to have a man of this caliber. I also want to thank Reverend Tim Lewis and the New England Shores Baptist Church. They are true friends of local veterans. Your support makes it possible for us to carry out our mission, not only one of veterans helping veterans, but also veterans giving back to our community. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Do we have any questions, comments?
Great. That sounds great. I'm glad your accomplishments went so well last year, and I'm sure they'll go just as good this year.
Thank you, man. I'll be back. We'll be back next year to report.
Great news to hear. It's always good.
Thank you.
Mr. Griffin?
Thank you very much for coming in tonight. It's inspiring to know that you have all these people behind you and you work so hard.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Paul, Sergeant Major, Skipper, Commander, you're stout-hearted, you're noble. It's a wonderful, wonderful organization. Thank you for everything you do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Commander, I'd like to thank you and all the veterans for your service to the country, and I'd also like to thank you and all the members of the Post for everything you do for Hampton and everything you do for our community and the ceremonies that you do put on, that you provide. They're absolutely inspirational, and I think they're well-deserved and well-appreciated by everybody. So thank you very much for everything you guys do.
Thank you, Jim. Appreciate it. Thank you, John.
Moving on, six, approval of minutes, April 11th, 2016.
I just have one edit to it.
Okay.
Page four, like the fourth person up, it's just Gordon Player. P-L-A-Y-E-R.
Okay.
As in baseball player. Just the name is wrong, that's all.
All right.
So. With that correction, so moved.
All in
second.
Favor?
Second.
Yeah. Oh, second. Oh. All in favor? All right. Very good. And minutes of April 18th. Anybody have any editorial or any fixes?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? All right. That's passed. Now we go to the town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, folks, please don't forget that the townwide cleanup is this week involving yard waste except for branches of wood, just grass, leaves, similar items. I will make the comment that one of our trucks broke down today, so if they didn't show up on the route, please wait. They'll be there. We had to get the truck fixed in order to do that. Please license your dog. Your dog's current license expires on this Saturday, April 30th. Please be aware the town clerk closes at 11:30 a.m. on Fridays. This Friday being the end of the month, please come in for your new registration earlier in this week so that you won't miss that line. You don't want to stand that line for as long as it takes on the last day or the first day of the following month. That's important. Mr. Chairman, we have a couple of other things. It seems that Monday is the day when everybody wants to come in and talk about coming before the board or throwing something up for your information or knowledge or whatever. And I did receive today a communication from the Department of Resources and Economic Development regarding our JOP for the beach. And I request that the JOP be renewed. I went through the JOP from last year, and there was only one change, and that was to go from regular colored bags, which we provide so that we can divide out the collection between the town and the state. The state bags are from their side of the street. The non-colored bags are from ours. The color is yellow. And this year they put in a requirement that it had to be coated. So we'd like to take that out because, frankly, coated bags cost more money because they actually have to have a code embedded in them. The other thing was that last year we gave permission, the board gave permission for the state to use the entrance up in Bicentennial Park to the beach area so that they could get down that end of the beach and clean their north beach. And during the construction up there, Their contractor decided to take some liberties and walk around with their heavy equipment on our Bicentennial Park, which has caused some problems. We'd like to amend the agreement so that it specifically states that the area that where they may have access to is the last 30 feet of Bicentennial Park, which is where the driveway is, and at no other location. Other than that, Public Works is ready to go. Everything worked very well this year. There were no problems. And with your permission, I'll put this on the agenda for the coming meeting on May 9th so that you can have time to review this and then we can vote on it later, unless you want to vote on it now.
And the JOP?
The JOP.
I prefer to wait for the chairman.
I thought you would. We would like to request that the board, as you know, some time ago, the board at our request had closed off the Church Street pump station parking lots. We'd like to request that those be reopened. There is no further need for us to close those. The signs have been taken down. The area is now open, and they're going to be doing a little work fixing it up a little bit so folks can use it this summer. It probably will need to be used if town meeting passes a requirement to replace the piping up there next spring, but that'll be before it's normally needed. But we would like to get people back in there and parking and feeling at home in town again. And so we would like to
request. Do you need a motion?
I do, because you did make
a
motion.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
All in favor? Unanimous.
And in that respect, we had a request from the Greyhurst. It's a different request. It's an unusual request. They had a request for they've already paid their fees, by the way, to use the parking lot at Ashworth Avenue starting this weekend because they have people coming in for shows, and they've already paid fees. One of the things that we have been looking at is extending the season, and we'll be coming back to you later on with a change in schedule for the time the parking lots are open and the fees that are involved in there just be a pro rata increase based on the number of days. We would like to have them open more often so that we can accommodate the activities at the casino and generate more income for the community. But we would ask your permission, since this does require your permission because it's 15 days early. If it was just a single weekend, you'd already set the precedent that if it's more than a weekend, we need to come to board. So we would request that they be allowed to use it for the next 15 days, and they have paid the fees.
Okay, we need a motion on that?
Yes, sir, you do.
A motion.
Regina made the motion, second by Mr. Bean. All in favor? It's unanimous.
That's all I have, sir. Yes, that's all I have, sir.
Questions for the town manager? Regina?
I have nothing. Thank you.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Griffin?
Did we want to respond to Mr. Silberdick? I mean, I know that a lot of those things were discussed. For instance, the about the thing at the police station, they needed to keep it because that's where they had it before or whatever. There were some strong factors to continue using that vendor. Did you want to respond to any of those other
I can.
Comments?
I had a feeling that what we should do is at the next meeting,
mm-hmm.
have the town attorney.
Yep.
Discuss the legality of what took place. So just clear up the question that it was whether it was legal or illegal. Clear it up, put it out there in the public. The public can look at it, and you know we'll give a good, clear definition of what took place and why it took place.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea too. But I think Fred could respond a little bit.
But I'd like to have Mark here, and so it's.
I know, but why? Why? I mean,
because then you're clearing it up. There's question. There's people who are saying, you know, was this done properly? And I think we can answer it. I mean, we've nothing to hide, so I think we can answer it. And I don't see a problem myself.
Well, I think the reason something should be said now because he's made these accusations, and this is going to be in people's mind, and
okay,
they're not necessarily
now,
true.
And then we could have Mark
and have Mark back it up.
That's fine.
I mean, I think, well, it's in people's, fresh in people's mind, because I know why, but he painted one side of the picture.
Well, and of course, that's all you really get an opportunity to do when you public speak, is to give your particular side of a particular issue. And I recognize that he did that from his particular standpoint. The board, in looking at what would have been 70-some warrant articles, decided that they needed to go through the individual department heads and pick items that were of emergency nature. For instance, the cameras in the police station. And to start the process on making purchase orders up to pay those items, given the estimate of the incoming revenue at the end of the year, because we had been holding funds because of the $350,000 overrun of the Department of Public Works. The vendor that was selected, and I have to tell you, there were two vendors. I can't name the other one at the moment, but there were two vendors. This vendor was the one that originally installed the system, that had designed it, and would be the ideal vendor to reposition it, because they understand the electronics and it's their electronics. That was the reason that they were selected by the chief of police, and they were the low of the two, which made good sense to us. I think I probably ought to make the comment at this point that there have been many times, and this board is not the one who's responsible for this, but on previous boards where we would sometimes bid 3, 4, 5, and 6 times on a particular item. And as we get through these bidders, in order to try to get 3 bidders to qualify under the bid statute or the bid regulation, we would end up with no bidders. Because people don't want to keep on rebidding. It didn't change anything. We have a number of different things where we go and bid things, and it's difficult to get even one bidder in some cases. I'll go to the fire department and address the equipment that they had. Almost all of that equipment that they wanted is single source. The vehicles that they wanted for the replacing the chief and deputy chief's vehicles was on the state bid. That was approved by the board in advance, which is a requirement under the personnel or under the purchasing policy. We tried to comply with all of those purchasing items. We went to state bids. We went to federal bids in some cases to look at those. So it was very difficult to get all those things done and yet come back to the board at their request to remove certain items from the budget and from the warrant articles. So there was a reason behind it. I don't believe that we were purposely circumventing town meeting. The fact of the matter is, and I'll use the cameras as a good example, we've all seen the news. We've all seen things that have been going on in police stations around the United States that shouldn't be. One of the reasons we have the cameras is to make sure it doesn't happen here. We need that for security for ourselves and our taxpayers. And we are working on that system actively, trying to get it back in shape. It's a big job.
And it looks to me like one reason why people don't want to bid for work here in Hampton is because there is so much controversy, always in the newspaper by rational taxpayers of Hampton and other things. I think it hurts the town, and that this looks like a very uncooperative place to do business. And I'm sure that adds to bigger bids coming in when they do come in.
We do have vendors who have told us they will no longer bid for the town of Hampton because of the requirements.
I've heard that from other people, and I've heard it through the years, actually. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I didn't hear what Mr. Silbertic had to say, and I don't pay much attention to his diatribes as the head of the Rochester, or the Rational Taxpayers, whatever the organization is, that anonymous organization, and I've said this before. Mr. Silbertic is an elected official in Hampton, but he likes to wear two hats, and secret societies and secret organizations, when you assume a mantle of leadership and he is the chairman of a $20 million trust fund, I think is inappropriate. In an effort to appease his quest to find some wrong, I would like, in preparation for the next meeting, an opinion from our auditors that found no discrepancies last year. If we can get that, Mr. Welch?
Certainly, sir.
A statement specifically to address any assertions that he made this evening or last week or through his website. I would like the chief of police to be here to offer his, and if need be, any subordinate at the police department that participated in that purchase. And I would like your input and finances as well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, I agree.
Okay. So, and we are going to have Mark here for that. Like,
you will?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
I mean, that'll just clear it up, and that'll be good. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for your report. Old business. Parking restrictions, we already did it.
We already did it. You're way ahead of the game.
And now this one. Letter of deficiency, Old Mill Pond Dam.
We had an inspection a couple weeks ago. DES needs to inspect on a frequency of the dam, all the dams in the state, and we received our notice of inspection that was due. I contacted the Public Works Department, and they called DES and scheduled an early inspection so that we could help that get into the system of the rehabilitation of the dam. We didn't want any surprises when it came to preparing the final contract documents and getting permits and so on and so forth. They came in, they took a look, they came back with a series of orders for the town between June 1st, 2016 and November 1st, 2017. The orders look pretty standard, at least from what I know of the dam or what I know of the process to replace the dam, with what would happen anyhow in fact carrying out that project, which the town has voted. It's necessary for them to update the operation and maintenance and emergency response. We have a new one. It's will be updated and sent back to the state for approval. I don't see that as a problem. It has to be done by June 1st. December 1st, to submit all the necessary environmental permit applications for the dam reconstruction and dredging, to reconstruct the dam in accordance with environmental regulations for the dam's hazard classification of significant, and that will be done. We're planning on, hopefully, even getting in the ground before then. By November 1st, 2017, to complete the reconstruction of the dam in accordance with permits obtained from the state. We're supposed to cut all trees, brush, and woody growth from the footprint of the earthen embankment of the dam and 15 feet beyond the footprint of the dam to prevent damage to the dam through root penetration or channeling. Blowdown of all trees. And create a buffer zone to monitor the dam for seepage and other maintenance concerns. Of course, several seepages will be fixed as we go through this process. The upstream right-hand embankment will need additional repairs according to their statements here. A large diameter tree along the right embankment, which is actually up almost on the driveway of the abutting properties, is to be removed along with all the trees along that left embankment. They want them all off the left embankment, which is supporting a driveway, but they're afraid it's channeling information past the dam itself as far as water is concerned. All stumps and exposed roots in the footprint of the dam are to be, and the embankment are to be removed. That deals with the reconstruction. And the eradicate all rodent and animals, burrows, and holes along the crest of the dam. The once eradicated, backfill holes with suitable compacted material, then loam, seed, and revegetate those areas and establish a heavy grassy cover. They want us to remove the existing concrete emergency spillway, and that portion of the dam, of course, would have to be reconstructed as far as the backside of the dam is concerned. Remove the metal pipe from the crest of the dam. It's about 70 feet from the left of the primary spillway. Fill, compact, seed, mulch the dam's embankment, and bring it to a minimum of 6 feet in the upstream and downstream direction. So they want the dam basically leveled, compacted, and they want a heavy sod cover is what they're asking for. Remove all debris located in the spillway. That's all the rocks. Past problems with debris and beavers have reduced the dam's full discharge potential. Monitor seepage at the base of the right and left sides of the embankments of the dam, and monitor the unstable downstream dry masonry walls that are overhanging the areas. One of the things that I think people are going to have some problems with is the fact that there is a ring of rocks about 20 feet out from the old dam face that continues to allow the dam or the body of water itself to continue some height. They want that removed completely as soon as possible. because they want that dam down to a certain point below the dam, the water down to a certain point below the dam face. I know that's going to cause some consternation on the part of some of the neighbors down there who will tell us that the flow is going to be cut back severely and that the otters and other animals that frequent that body of water are going to have to leave, and that's probably true because there won't be enough water for their habitat. That's what they want, and they've given us a schedule to do it, and we're required by law to accomplish it, and we will because the law requires us to. That's just a brief synopsis of what they've said.
Mr. Bean? In fiscal impact, where we are with money, where we have been with money, warrants, et cetera, cast history, if you're prepared to give a synopsis. If not, we can wait, sir.
I believe that we have sufficient funds to accomplish the endeavor that's been put forward by the state. They went over our funding. They believe that we have sufficient funding to do it and to come into compliance. Once the dam is rebuilt, a lot of these restrictions will go away. They're just temporary in nature. It's so that we make sure the dam can't breach or things of that nature. We have the money to reconstruct the dam, and we'll proceed to issue the bids once the engineering is completed and get the work done.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Griffin.
So when did this letter come in?
The letter is dated the 14th of April. I believe we received it a few days after that. I gave it to the board in your mailboxes shortly after that.
Mm-hmm.
They did their inspection on April 6th.
Is it possible that we can ask that the two people that are here have some input? Because they are the ones that have been working on this. Maybe they will have something to do.
Yeah, can we wait till we go around? Regina?
Yeah, I don't have anything further. I think I agree with Rick. I think that would be a great idea. Yeah.
Where do we sit right now with the reconstruction of the dam?
Engineering-wise, we're working with engineers.
We're working with engineers.
Yeah. Now, we have to start implementing this order immediately. We have a choice. Or the state will come in and do it for us. I don't want that to happen simply because we'll lose complete control. I don't want that to happen. Either that or they can fine us. They're being, at least from what I've seen of these reports from other places and other times, they're being extremely lenient in what they're doing. They have a parameter in which they want to work, in which they want the town to work. And that parameter is pretty mild because they know we're in the process of going to reconstruct the dam. Because at this point, they could just simply say, tear it all down.
Do they have issues in New Hampshire with beaver dams?
Oh, yes.
Because I saw a special on TV about it yesterday. I don't know if anyone saw it, but it's on Nature, and it's called Leave It to Beaver.
Yeah.
And it's on PS, you know, PBS.org. It was a very, very, very interesting show. And, you know, the basic thing that I never realized, it's the sound of moving water that pulls the beavers.
Oh, yeah.
And they just are constantly trying to stop that moving water.
And they're very successful.
I was curious of how that affected that, because you do hear that water there all the time. But it said that actually beaver dams work better than man-made ones.
You're absolutely correct. During the World War II, at the beginning of World War II, the Army Corps of Engineers had to build the Alcan Highway from Washington State to Alaska, and they had hundreds of river crossings to do. So rather than damming them, they put beavers in, let the beavers dam them. Yeah. And they could build their bridges and without any problem at all. These guys are great engineers.
And yeah, that's what they said. And little, did they live in there? I never knew that. That's where they live in the wintertime.
Once they build their impoundment and their dam face, they will build a nest, a hut, in the middle of the impoundment area, and they have an entry to it underwater. They stock their food products there in the water and bring it in as they need it, and they stay there all winter. They have enough body heat to keep themselves warm.
Mm.
They're industrious little devils.
I have a question. Now, the warrant was passed 2015 town meeting, right?
We've had so many warrants.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, yes, 2015. 15. That's correct, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, people wonder probably what's the process been since 2015? You know, why are we here now?
Why are we here now?
Why has the dam not been refurbished already?
Oh, because we don't have the engineering data yet.
Okay.
Okay. And we have still one more engineering contract to issue, which has to go out and is in town council's hands at the current time.
Okay.
So we've got two different engineering firms working on the same project in different phases. So and whatever we do has to meet the requirements of DES, or we won't be approved. We've got to go back and do the work again. So we're being extremely diligent. We waited until we knew the ice pond dam either could be or couldn't be built. And that wasn't until late 2015 that we knew that, before we went to the 2016 town meeting. And that's when we started to move on this.
Okay.
Sorry.
So right now, currently, we have the engineering plans being drawn up.
We have the engineers. One's on staff, one's not. The other, it should be in it within probably a few days.
Okay. And once that's, then we go out to bid?
We'll go out to bid once we have those plans, which should be sometime mid-year, a little later. And then we'll have some costs and we'll have some decisions to make about what needs to be done or what needs to be rebid.
Okay. And what we have to do with this letter, will that affect the rebuilding of the dam?
No. This is to, I believe after reading this, my impression is that the state's trying to work with us. They feel compelled to give us an order that's directable and enforceable, to make sure that we, in fact, progress along a deliberate line for completion sometime in late 2017. And it may take that long, just depending on where the construction is and the weather conditions and the amount of water that we're dealing with and so forth on any particular time. If they didn't want us to comply or they wanted us to do something in the form of taking it down, this would have a date somewhere this summer to demolish the dam.
Okay. I welcome either one of you to come up and speak or both of you to come up and speak. You can sit up here at the table. Just introduce yourselves and...
Candy, you need to go on PBS and see that. It's really...
I was just talking
about
it.
It was great.
Can we pay the Beavers? I'm Candace Stelmack, 488 High Street.
I'm Jim Metcalf, 63 Edgewood Drive, Hampton, New Hampshire. Just to follow up a little bit, I attended the inspection at the invitation of Chris Jacobs, the Public Works Director. The fellow from the Dam Bureau was pretty thorough. I have not had an opportunity to review the report. It sounds to me a bit like they're trying to make sure that the hazard is controlled as best it can be.
Yeah.
Until the work on the dam is complete. In the conversation I had with the fellow from the Dam Bureau, he seemed to be pretty satisfied with the progress that the town was making on securing the services of an engineer designer to provide the plans for the reconstruction of the dam and then ultimately for the actual reconstruction of the dam. So my view, I'm a little bit surprised that they're requiring that the level be lowered for the time being, if that's what I understand.
That's what they're requiring. Yeah.
And I'm surprised at that a little bit, but I can understand it. You know, they're concerned about the stability of the structure,
right,
in the interim next couple of years until this job is complete. I guess I wish it were not necessary, but I understand their perspective that it may be. So to me, the process is moving along pretty much the way that I had thought it would be moving along. Just by way of background, we are the group that Sandy and I, Candy and I represent. Is interested in the successful reconstruction of the dam and the maintenance of the historical character of the structure, the complex that's there, and we were recognized by the Board of Selectmen as folks who could perhaps participate in that. Myself and another fellow who happened to have an engineering background, retired, were invited to by the DPW. To participate in the interviewing of the various contractors, prospective contractors. So you know, everything that has happened thus far is pretty much what I expected to see happen, and certainly I have no problem with it personally. I can't speak for the entire group, but from my perspective, things are moving along well.
I did get a call from one of the people that was contacted from an engineering firm to supply the historical register so that they could try and save money and not redo a lot of the work that we had done previously, and they were very happy to receive that and thought it helped a lot.
Good. Anything else?
Thank you.
Thank you. I think that updates people. I think the public, anybody watching, you know, is updated on where we're going and where it's currently at. So now this letter, can that be on the website, or is that?
Oh, we can put this on the website. It's just it's a state order.
I tried to find it, and I couldn't find it on the town website. I couldn't even find it on the Dambuer website, so I'm not sure.
Yeah, we couldn't find it there either, so I'm glad they sent us a lot of information.
Okay, good.
But we'll have
good.
It posted on the town website, great. And then people can go there and get
that
it.
That would be helpful.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, we do keep a record of all of those letters and all of the inspections since 1935.
Well, I used to have a complete file. The whole file has disappeared. I don't know who's got
it. Well, I can give you another one.
No, well, I think Public Works may have it, or one of the engineers has it, but we did have a complete file, and I think it went back even further than 1935.
Oh, that'd be interesting.
Yeah.
Some people are interested in knowing what the levels were, and I didn't see anything on the reports that said that.
I don't think what I've seen in the past is that the levels were not talked about. And that was kind of distressing to me, having worked on a couple of dams, not knowing what the levels had been historically over the years. The only thing I think I really got excited about was when we had the Mother's Day storm and our then Public Works Director took a backhoe up there and started tearing rocks out of the dam. That was unnecessary, I think, because it just caused some additional problems that we're going to have to clean up. But at the time, it looked like it was going to overflow, and we didn't want to have that happen either. So it's the devil you do and the devil you don't. You got to deal with both of them at the same time. I think the state, you know, the report that I got, and I did not attend the inspection, but the report that I got from everybody in our organization that was there and has talked to people in Concord is the state wants to be helpful, and they would like to see this done and done right and in such a manner that the facility that's finished and built will be a benefit to the town and everybody in it.
Yeah, that was my perspective as well. And speaking of the level of the lake, of the pond, that was one of the questions that the inspector raised. You know, what historically has the level been,
right,
and what would the town want to achieve with respect to a level?
Right.
You know, higher than it was currently or lower or whatever. And the response that Chris gave was the correct response, which is that's one of the things that will be evaluated by the engineers as part of them doing the job that they've got to do. So certainly they're interested in what that level will finally end up being, and I guess historically it has varied quite a bit. That's
I've seen it very substantially since I got here in 2007, and that's simply because of different things that have been done by different people. So. But, yeah, I think we do. We will need to establish a level at the time the dam is finished, and we will need to put in the necessary retainment boards to accomplish that level so we can raise and lower the level depending upon issues and problems.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your input. Anything else under old business? Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
Mr. Griffin?
No, thank you.
No, thank you.
New business, amend 805-45, speed limits established. Open quotes, B, limit of 25 miles per hour, close quotes, to add the following streets: Dearborn Avenue, Hackett Avenue, Kershaw Avenue, and Moore Avenue. Want to give us an explanation of that, sir?
Mr. Chairman, you will remember in the last year, we have had a number of complaints from all of these streets with regards to speed. We still have those complaints coming in. The only way to effectively answer those complaints is to establish a speed limit on those roads. Some of them are extremely short, Kershaw, Hackett, Moore, but yet people drive in excess of 25 miles an hour down those roads. In fact, in some cases, even faster than that. I don't know how, but they do. The board had authorized us to look at those streets and to come back with a plan. One of our plans is to uniformly lower the speed limit to 25 miles an hour. The number of children living on the street, the number of people living on the street, the fact that the street has a number of blind areas makes it dangerous and therefore needs a lower limit. There's a lot of traffic that frequents that street and does so at high speed in some cases. We've actually been having the police department up there from time to time running radar, and that has helped. You also authorized us, and we're going to do this sometime later this summer, to put in a quieting device, which will slightly raise the level of the road on Moore Avenue to keep the traffic calmed down a little bit. You'll just barely notice a rise in the road and then a drop in the road. The calming devices that we're going to put down are something that we would take up in the wintertime. They just simply nail in place, bolt in place, and it will allow us to plow in the winter, but it will slow traffic down somewhat during the summertime, and the speed limit will help a little bit in that area, too. So we were requesting that the limit be established. There is no limit currently on the road legally.
Do you need a motion?
To amend it, yes, sir.
I'll make the motion.
I'll second.
Anybody, any comments? I'm amazed how you can get more than 25 miles an hour on those streets. They're so small. I mean, I agree we should lower the speed limit, but I'm amazed how anybody could.
They can.
It's a very short street, yeah.
I know.
All right, so all in favor? Passes unanimously.
It looks like there on the corner, there is a business gone in there.
On Kearshaw?
What's the main, is it, I guess it's.
Off of Dearborn, it's Moore.
Dearborn and Ann's Lane, right on that corner there.
No, oh no, no, they put up a sign because there is a contractor doing work in the house.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh no, I checked that out immediately.
I thought maybe it was turning into an office.
No. Yeah. No, there's no business going in there. He's just advertising his work, that's all. Oh. And hopefully wants to get some more customers, I guess.
I hope he does as good a job. His sign looks pretty good.
It did.
You notice it.
Did look very good.
Okay, approve two under new business. Approve letter to PERP, P-R-E-P, for the PERP A grant outreach.
Right.
And could you explain that to us?
Yeah, well, it gets kind of complicated when you start using all those initials. But the bottom line here is that we are engaged in a grant outreach that from the Regional Planning Commission dealing with the Regional Estuary Partnership. That grant project cannot be used to meet compliance with EPA municipal's separate storm sewer system permits or the MS4 we keep on talking about all the time. So this is a requirement of that grant that the selectman authorize a letter that will certify that we will not use those funds for MS4 purposes, only for the grant purposes, because the federal law requires us to do that in order to keep the grant.
Okay.
That's it.
We have a motion. Second?
Yeah.
Any discussion? All in favor? Unanimous. Very good. Three, agreement for household hazardous waste collection.
I wish we could just give it to somebody for free, but we can't. Mr. Chairman, we are going to try to do this at the beginning of June. I'm going to let Public Works make all the announcements and all the good things that need to happen. We received the contract for this work, and it was minus a couple of important ingredients. One, general coverage insurance, and the other was for workers' compensation insurance. So we have inserted them because they're statutory requirements under the law. And with that, I would issue, with your permission, the agreement to do the household hazardous waste collection day at the beginning of June. June 4th, I believe it is. The towns of Center Harbor, excuse me. No. Too many towns in my mind. Hampton Falls and Newcastle are going to participate with us. So we're going to split these costs three ways, which I think is acceptable. And the state is going to participate with us, too, by giving us some of the source funds to do this project. So the state's overseeing this. I won't issue the contract without these general coverages for workers' compensation in here, which are required by New Hampshire law. And that's the reason I'm here tonight, asking for you to approve that, because those insurance coverages need to be in there. They were not in the original contract. I will not do it without those, because the law says I can't.
Okay. Questions?
Negative.
I have no questions.
And it's going to take place at the Public Works facility.
Who's going to supervise it?
Our Public Works employees and our director and assistant director are going to supervise it. We'll also have additional people to help supervise and run the operation from the other two towns. We're each going to share our employees uniformly across this process. We're going to hold it in an area where there are no catch basins, just dirt. If there is a spill, we can clean it up and take it up to transfer station and dump it. So it'll be taken away. We're not anticipating there will be any. The area will be covered with protective claws so that we'll have that additional protection. As you remember, the district we used to belong to held a household hazardous waste day behind the fire station, and they had a spill, and they tried to cover it up. And the firefighters saw what was going on, although the people who were managing it did not, because they kept it kind of secret. And we fortunately were able to catch anything before anything happened. It did get into one of the catch basins, and we cleaned that catch basin plus the one below it and blocked off all entrances from the one below it. So, and the company was made to pay for all those expenses, both the state supervision and the supervision of the district. So all the towns were made whole. We just don't want to take that chance anymore.
So at that time, they ran it themselves?
They ran it under the supervision of the Solid Waste District.
Okay, and now we...
We're going to run it, and we're going to be a lot more cautious than they were, I think.
Okay.
We're very sensitive to this. This is going to be held in the Public Works facility, and our folks work there, and they don't want to have a problem, obviously, neither do we. So this is going to be well monitored and supervised.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
I'll second.
Mr. Griffin, Regina, all in favor? Passed.
Thank you, sir.
Unanimous. Anything else under new business?
I was just wondering, now, are the guys from, this is actually old business, but the cable people guys working on getting that consultant that they were talking about?
They're going this coming Thursday, I believe, to look at equipment stuff, and yes, they're working on that.
Good.
Anybody else with anything on new business or old business? You know, we're on new business. Closing comments. Regina?
Nothing.
Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
Mr. Griffin?
No.
Remember, our next meeting isn't until May 9th.
Next meeting is May 9th. And also at the next meeting, we will have Mr. Bridle back at that time.
You did a wonderful job, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Do I have a motion to adjourn at 20:03?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Adjourn.